Welcome to our panel discussion on the very interesting topic of partnerships with universities, collaborative research and positive impact for society. And I'm happy to hand over the word to Bridget Wessels from the University of Glasgow, who will take over the role of moderator of this panel.
Thank you very much, Judith. And as always, it's lovely to be working with you at Leuphana and obviously at Glasgow in this partnership. I think before we just do some housekeeping on question and answer, I'd just like to welcome everybody to this session of the conference, but also particularly to our speakers of the panel. Each of them brings a unique set of experience, insights, and knowledge to the debate. But before I actually introduce them to you, we've just got a little bit of housekeeping in terms of how to do the Q&A. And I think there should be a Q&A slide coming up in a second. So in terms of the question and answers, we've got 35 minutes sort of discussion at the end of the talk. So each speaker will give a 10 to 15 minute talk. And what we'd like you to do is, if you want to ask a question to the panelists, click on the Q&A, which is on the right-hand side of your bottom sort of bar. I think in German it's F&A. If you could kindly type in your name and organisation followed by your question, so we know who's asking the question and which organisation you're representing. I'll then pick up those and I'll put those to the panellists. If you want to actually name a particular panellist you'd like that question to be directed to, please also pop that into the Q&A. Thanks a lot, Judith. I think we can leave the screen sharing now. All right. So I think, you know, over the years, we've often had, you know, regular sort of sessions on interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, transdisciplinary, multi-sector and partnerships and so on and so forth. So I think, I'm pleased we've got this again. And I think I'm really pleased we've got it because although it's a regular issue and point that people talk to, I do think partnerships and collaboration for positive impacts on society are particularly relevant. You know, here in Glasgow, we've just had COP26, and I think that notion of the environment and the sort of the richness and diversity and complexity of addressing that challenge really shows that we need people with different sets of experience, different knowledge, and coming from different backgrounds in order to understand that challenge. And when we look at sort of current societal challenges, we've certainly got the environment. But I think linked with the environment, we've got issues around energy. We've also got questions about productivity and growth. What kinds of productivity? How do we want to grow? As well as ensuring that any sort of social change or transformation enables our populations to be secure, safe, but also to feel empowered and participatory. When we think of COVID-19, there's an issue there of the safety and security of populations in how we develop vaccines and distribute vaccines, but how we do that in an equitable way, actually at the global level. And of course, all of this is tightly woven in with notions of our culture. There's an issue around diversity, social exclusion, but as well as fragmentation. We see masses, you know, world events, we see migrations, we see different kinds of distinctions and divisions emerging around often contestations around resources, but also around security. So how do we actually develop a culture that is at once shared around some of these issues, but also recognises diversity within that? And of course, all of these are really tied into how, in terms of transformation, what do we mean by innovation? Is innovation necessarily progressive? And if so, on what shared social values? So how might we think about doing things differently that benefit our planet, but also benefit the peoples who live on that planet? And I think these are huge challenges. And in fact, in many ways, if we think of the history of universities, going back to the theology colleges. In many ways, as well as the sort of development of red brick universities during the first industrial revolution, these sorts of social challenges, economic challenges and resource challenges were all the things that faced, if you like, our knowledge communities. So in order to address the contemporary challenges, which are huge, this requires, I think, disciplinary, interdisciplinary, whether trans, multi, or, you know, different kinds of the disciplines coming together in particular ways. It requires different kinds of knowledge and expertise and experience. And all of this, in some sense, needs to be understood contextually. So how do we actually come together to understand how we bring different insights from different disciplines, different knowledge and different experience in a contextual way, and configure that to address both something that might be specific, but might have larger impact on broader social challenges? And here we have to think about the characteristics of our partnerships. How can we come together? Which type of partners with which type of expertise, but how do those partnerships work? And of course, part of that development of partnerships, is it also about developing new communities of innovation? How might we situate innovation within different communities across the globe? So we see really examples from Brazil in terms of water management, different ways of kind of data management that's from the memories and understandings of local people, as well as abstract data. So in many ways, the challenges, which I think can only be achieved through progressive, creative and inspiring partnerships, is fostering new ways of looking at things. There's almost a paradigm shift. We need to create a new kind of language, new concepts, new theories, but new ways to talk about these particular issues. And new methodologies in terms of developing research and knowledge, but also in terms of implementation and application of particular solutions. And of course, here this means strongly looking at the relationship between research and policy. How might we develop policy? What kinds of policy? Who's included in that policy making and the agenda setting of policy? And of course, critically, we need to look at routes to market and how we might sustain those markets and how the market might function in a different way in terms of some of these social challenges. So I think many, many thanks to our speakers, but what we need to sort of look at now is the interface and think about the interface between research, different kinds of research, the interface of research and policy, the interface of research and practice, and how we bring those imaginaries together to develop a progressive way in which knowledge is developed in our societies for the diversity of our population. So I do think we're at a particular moment. I might have been sort of infused by the COPT being in Glasgow, but you do actually touch the pulse. And I think our young people and our students here are particularly switched on to this. And I think there's something there about engaging young people in some of these discussions. So you're not here to listen to me. You're here to listen to a really great set of speakers. And I'm going to introduce them just all briefly and not do the introduction before the talk. So you'll have read their bios, but James McCallum, really, I think I'm delighted he can actually come and join us because as we were talking a little bit before this session started, his 40 years of upstream energy experience, of looking at the energy market, understanding energy and what needs to be done there, I think is crucially important. And the kind of partnerships and relationships he's built over those 40 years will be particularly insightful for us. I think Andreas, very much, and bringing us another perspective, looking at innovative business, and particularly the trajectories of innovation startups. So where might an idea come from? Where might it go to? And how that relates to some of those challenges. I'm delighted to have Rebekah Widdowfield with us. And really, she's Chief Executive of the Royal Society of Scotland, and I think really focusing on that policy research interface and interaction and relationship, which is, of course, is crucial when we come to look at partnerships. And I think Paul very much taking and looking at the entrepreneurial aspect of that, but really quite sort of taking a different lens, looking at communities and looking at how communities can be dealt and the next steps in cooperation and transfer, knowledge transfer, and how we might do that. We know that's a problematic area. So thinking about how we might think of that differently. And then Stuart Patrich, sadly can't be with us, but he's provided a video. He's chief executive of Glasgow Chamber of Commerce. And Stuart's very much looking at how working with Glasgow and the different institutions of Glasgow, including Glasgow University, has actually informed not just the economic redevelopment of Glasgow, but how Glasgow as a city and its partnerships within that interacts at a global level in terms of, you know, development, growth, and also an inclusive, affordable city, a usable city. And I think that's actually very important. So without further ado, James, can I hand over to you to sort of get the ball rolling for us, so to speak?
Yeah, you certainly can, Bridget, and thank you for the kind introduction. First thing I would like to do, just before I kind of start into what I was going to say, just pick up on a couple of the things that you mentioned there, that success is going to be about tapping into different knowledge bases and recognizing the different characteristics of partners. And nowhere perhaps is that more true, I think, than in seeking collaboration between business, politicians, and academia. And indeed, you referenced, of course, that we've just had COP26 in Glasgow. And in many ways, that, if you like, was a forum dominated by the politicians. But you also referenced that at the heart of it was a subject where we have an enormous challenge in front of us around how we manage access and the use of energy and what energy actually means in our common dialogue and how we actually manage that in terms of our planet and our environment. You are right to identify that I have had a 40-year career in the upstream energy sector, and of course, the upstream energy sector has been dominated by the delivery of hydrocarbons, something which we now look at with a much greater level of acuteness in terms of the role that it plays in our energy mix around the world, where it comes from, how it's utilized, how it will be utilized, and the consequences of that utilization. And I think you mentioned, I think, perhaps the bit which I get most excited about. And whilst I suspect that for many of your students and many of the people online, taking oneself back to the late 1970s and the early 1980s is almost practically impossible. The reality is that was an enormous pivotal moment in terms of the planet because, you know, we were beginning to move away from fossil fuels in the form of coal and into the world of oil and gas. And here we find ourselves now. You are absolutely correct. Another pivotal moment in society where we are having to move to a new generation of energy sources, which we don't yet have technical solutions or technological solutions for. And so we have a compelling issue to deal with, and we have to come together to sort that. And I think when you reference COP, perhaps the most meaningful thing to come out of COP is the fact that we are going to have to do this together. And together's, of course, is ultimately perhaps the best collaborative word that's out there. Now, for me, I am a businessman. I have been in business, building businesses since the early 1980s. And the introduction there, as I spoke to you earlier on, said I was chief executive of Senergy. That's just a little bit out of date. I was chief executive and founder of the Senergy Group, which I built over 15 years. That business I sold on in 2013. I'm now chairman and chief executive of exergy, which is in a different space, very much in the, and if you like, the fourth industrial revolution. You talked about the third industrial revolution, the fourth one, of course, very much anchored in the digital transformation that the world has to go through. And I'll come back to that. But when I'm talking about partnerships into academia, I will come at it from the business perspective. And indeed, I kind of want to touch on five C's. And you know, whilst five C's probably would rarely get you anywhere in any university, as a foundation for a partnership here, I would ask you to give it due consideration. The first is commercial. You know, any partnership between business and academia has to have a dimension of commerciality to it. Yeah, as we learned in COP, where the financial industry has taken a very strong lead in beginning to address who will access capital to do things in the future. And that's capital, whether you're in the energy sector, the manufacturing sector, or any sector. The world is going to change around liquidity and access to capital. That has also been impacted by COVID, but I don't think we should go into that just now. So always bear in mind that business leaders will always have to have in mind, you know, what is my route to profitability here? How am I going to return value to my shareholders and what I'm actually about to embark on? Clearly, as we go forward and we start to embrace particularly the rules and regulations which are going to come through from the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures, where we're going to have to lay out the landscape of not just how our business performs, in other words, managing our carbon footprint, but actually moving forward and actually changing the cultural way in which we actually conduct business. It's not just about planting trees to mitigate a carbon footprint which you actually have. It's actually about doing business in a very, very different way, managing your supply chain, managing the elements that actually go into your product, and actually making sure that you're doing your bit, not just for the environment, but for the world in general. And so carbon is my second C. You know, we all have a duty to move the world towards a net zero position. We are very, very fortunate to be in a part of the world where this is a conversational point where it's relatively easy. I listened a couple of weeks ago to a podcast where a leading Indian industrialist actually took the question around how did he feel about India and China at the end of COP, if you like, being the focus of negativity around the position which they took on coal. And he made a very impassioned plea for the world to understand that in India, 70% of the electrical generation comes from coal. So when we're asking a country like India to back away from coal, what do they have as an alternative? What are we in the West actually going to do to help them to address that? And of course, that is something which is all about my third C, which is this collaboration. And that is obviously going to be the theme of today. But it's collaboration, not just across business and academia, it is genuinely also to embrace the political landscape. In the energy sector, in the upstream energy sector, as we move through and into this current millennium around the year 2000, the industry faced an enormous challenge when in actual fact, commodity prices collapsed to a level where the industry was no longer commercial. And in that moment, the industry came together with the politicians, created government industrial landscape collaboration to actually solve that problem. And I want to see the same thing again. I want to see those kind of task force, those kind of intellectual groups coming together to address the challenges which we actually have. And I think academia, as well as the politicians, have a real role to play in that. And that's key to our success. My fourth C is connectivity, and that absolutely plays to this point around the fourth industrial revolution. Connectivity for me means two things. It means, first of all, how we maintain connectivity across the process by which we're actually delivering success, looking at the methodologies and the business processes by which we do what we do, and actually embracing that as part of the digital transformation to make sure that our processes are as efficient and effective as they can be. And ultimately that comes down to managing our resources. And our resources take three forms. They are hardware, they are software, and they are intellectual. And the second part, therefore, of that connectivity is around how you achieve the optimum connectivity to knowledge and liberate that knowledge into the solution that you're actually trying to drive to. We are about to enter a very, very different part of that pivotal change that you're talking about in the world of a knowledge economy, where it's estimated that by 2030, some 80% of people will work in a gig economy. Instant access to knowledge and instantly able for that knowledge to be applied to projects, but equally for it to be turned off. And clearly, where we're talking about accessing knowledge in that manner, academia plays a huge part in that, because the gig economy is redefining what access to knowledge and capability actually means. Businesses will increasingly function with, if you like, less of a staff base and a lower footprint in terms of offices. They will tap into and use the power of the internet to tap into intellectual capability on the other side of the globe. And they will bring it into projects when they need it, and they will take it out of the projects when they no longer need it. So for me, that aspect of connectivity is the most exciting. The last C, the fifth C, is all around the quality of the conversation. And if you've got the right people in the room and you're asking the right questions, and there's my plea to the audience out there, and you take the time to make sure that you take the opportunity to ask the questions that you want answered, then we will all contribute to success. So those are my five C's.
Thank you very much, James. That was a really inspiring but also clear way to start this panel. And I, you know, for me, picking up on my area, which is digital and connectivity, it was really interesting to hear that. And I don't think we've connected up quite that notion of connectivity and the new kinds of connectivity to some of these other challenges. And I think that would be a really interesting area to explore in more detail. You know, if we ever have a chance to, I'd love to pick up on that. So
delighted.
Thank you very much. And Andreas, if I could hand over to you now for your talk. And in some ways, I guess you might be picking up on some of the issues James raised.
I could pick up on all of them, because they each and every one of them is extremely important. Let me pick up the last one, the quality of interaction. I just happened to me that I picked up the memoirs of Werner Heisenberg at the beginning of the last weekend. And it's actually, if you read the first pages, what he emphasizes, he says, my memoirs, they will not be historically correct, but what I really try to focus on is to lay out the spirit of the conversation which we had, which allowed us to reach new insights, because that was the key. I think what you said reminded me very much of the insight of Werner Heisenberg. I myself will touch on that with a couple of slides, which will reveal that I spent a couple of years as a consultant. We always used to, we can't work without slides. sorry for that. What I want to focus on is the key success factors of collaboration, because we have been touching the significance of collaboration between science, academia, and the political world as key to the big challenges we are facing on the world. We have seen it, and I've been involved in that, how important that has been for advancing during the COVID crisis, and how we had dismal failures where we lacked the right approach there. And therefore, I think what we need to acknowledge is yes, there are big, big issues out there in the world, but each of these issues and challenges we are trying to focus on is specific. It's a very specific, different question. Is there a role of nuclear energy at some stage in the transition towards a new energy world in the future? It's totally different to the question of the issue of carbon capture. And each of these issues, each of these specific issues, we will have academia, politicians, business to work together. And here I want to change to some slides. Let me see whether I find my one to share. I hope it does work. Can you see it?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Wonderful. Very pragmatically, if there's a challenge, and if we want to change the real world, there's a stretch to go through. We have to ask the question, why is there that what we think about the right strategic solution to the question? And then the question is, what do we need to do to make that strategic solution happen? What are the pillars? And how we are going to implement it. What I'm trying to say is addressing a particular challenge implies a whole value chain, and just publishing a paper hasn't changed society. And this implies that many people with different competences join there in collaboration. And it implies that they make errors and there will be feedback loops and they have to go through that again and again. And as it has been pointed out by Bridget and by James, the more complex issue is, and we are facing many different complex issues at the moment, the key to success is to bring different competences at the table to join forces. That's where the lever is to insight. The insight is at the boundaries. It's not within a specific area. If you look at the reason why CureVac didn't work as a vaccine while Pfizer and Moderna worked as a vaccine, it had to do because they lacked access to a specific scientific solution, which the other had access to, they didn't. Getting these different competencies to work together in a very effective manner is critical, and particularly in an environment where speed is required. We had the need for speed in the COVID crisis. If you look at the global ecological situation, there is a great amount of for speed. And therefore, we need to understand what makes it successful to speed up innovation processes and what can be the stumbling blocks. And the stumbling blocks, which I have experienced in many collaborations where not only academia and business and politicians came together, but also where business worked together, they have to do with a set of different hard barriers. The first one is incentive or priorities. I've experienced situations where the academic side was focused on publications, the business side was focused on commercial outcome. You basically didn't end up in a team which worked well. It has to do, but that's pretty straightforward. But on a deeper layer, there are maybe some much more fundamental and more difficult to issues to address. And they have to do with the experiences of people which they have accumulated during their life. If you recall Kahneman's slow and fast thinking, understanding the importance of accumulated stereotypes, impressions for our intuitive behavior and decision making, can give you an impression about how different people will react from different experience backgrounds, because they have a different approach to time, they have a different approach to the values patterns, they have a different modes of communication. The role models which are important for them may be totally different. And we need to expect that if we bring people together, if we bring politicians together, if we bring together politicians from different parties, and we need to bring together people from different parties, like the Greens, like the Liberals, like the Conservatives. Just among the group of politicians, we will find a huge diversity along those lines, which poses a challenge, a big challenge to collaboration. In addition, they have been trained with different tools, methods of working, and these alien worlds lead to subconscious anxieties, fears, misunderstandings. And that's what these stumbling blocks, we occur them in each and every major corporation where we bring together people to work together. And the more diverse the field is, and the more diverse the background is, academia, politicians, business, the more difficult it is to build a working environment where we have effective and fast innovation. Therefore, we need to anticipate that and to prepare for that. The goal is, in particular, there is a goal for all sides, with, as we have to learn about diversity and develop a culture of diversity, we have to develop a culture of learning how to collaborate across those boundaries. Along those lines, I put a couple of those lines on the slide here. Project skills, social skills, agile working, etc. So it is a challenge for institutions who work, collaborate with academia, or academia which collaborates with the commercial side, to make a special effort to develop those long-term capabilities. But if you launch a specific project, you should carefully think how you design the project to address that issue. Maybe, if, in particular, if the project is less complex, it's easier not to address them, but to give clear roles to everyone. Have a clear contract, stringent management. It's one option in particular for less complex projects. Otherwise, on the other hand, you can align interests by creating joint ventures, which we do have in particular in cases where universities actually split off new businesses in partnership with industry, which tend to work extremely well. In between, there are other projects where you might want to think about invest in teaming and building capabilities across teams so that the teams will have much stronger effectiveness afterwards. It's basic. It's nothing which is surprising, but I think if new projects initiatives are launched, it's one of the things which are largely overlooked. And as I've seen in the COVID crisis, many, many initiatives didn't succeed because this basis hadn't been laid between the participants at the beginning. I will leave you with these thoughts and hope they bring some useful discussion to the fore.
Thank you very much, Andreas. That's really useful. And I really recognise that, having done some interdisciplinary work, quite a lot actually, from PhD onwards of working with the private sector, public sector, and with universities. And I think had a lovely collaboration actually with some colleagues in Denmark and Sweden from computer science, human practice design, human work design, and myself as a sociologist. And it was working across the different sectors. The issue of time was really interesting because the university, a public sector, and a private sector organization each have a different sense of time and when they want things delivered and so on. So that you know, that really resonated. And I think we often think, oh, let's work together. But I think addressing some of those practicalities in a very clear and open way is certainly important for underpinning any kind of interdisciplinary multi-sectoral work. So I thought that was really useful. And I really like the way that you've brought us back to that, you know, the importance of it, but look at these things in a very concrete way. So many, many thanks. I think that's a really good contribution. Many thanks. And I think, Rebecca, I'll hand over to you now. And then I think probably looking at the policy research interface, which we'll probably talk to some of Andreas, but I think it's a nice precursor to what Paul will be talking about after you.
Thanks so much, Bridget. And I was going to offer some sort of more general remarks, I think, about collaboration, but I'll pick up with maybe around evidence and policy towards the end. But I mean, I do hope that I suspect there'll be few dissenters if I say that collaboration is a bedrock of both high quality research, but also impactful research and turning to the focus of the positive impacts for society. And I think particularly collaboration across disciplines, as a number of speakers have already mentioned and Bridget mentioned in her opening remarks, which allows us to take obviously a holistic approach to complex challenges. And you can see that obviously through COVID-19. Yes, we had the epidemiologists and the virologists and the modellers, but we also needed the economists and the behavioural scientists. And without any of those individually and collectively, we would have been much, much the poorer, particularly when you've got really complex choices. And governments have a really difficult role of weighing up those really complex choices, weighing up, for example, economics harms versus health harms, or shorter term health harms versus longer term health harms. So that interdisciplinarity is absolutely critical for a positive contribution. And of course, collaboration across institutes, which enables us to build critical mass and leverage funding for research. And we've seen that for quite a few years now in Scotland with research pools, which have covered a whole number of areas from energy to life sciences to physics and engineering, and a way of actually building that critical mass. But also, as a number of speakers have also referred to, that real importance of collaboration across academia with industry and with government that does underpin innovation and the practical application of research. But also, and I think obviously pretty poignant to today's conversation that draws together Lower Saxony and Scotland, is actually collaboration across geographical boundaries to support the sharing of intellectual and physical resources and the collective advancement of knowledge and understanding. And I think it's probably not an overstatement, I don't think, to say that collaboration across disciplines, institutes, sectors and geographies might be described as the DNA of RSE as Scotland's National Academy. For those of you who are less familiar with us, we were founded in 1783 for the advancement of learning and useful knowledge, and that remains our mission to this day. But we're quite unusual for a national academy in that we cover the breadth of academia. So we have a fellowship that involves people from the life sciences, the natural sciences, the arts and humanities, and the social sciences. But we also bring in people from business and from wider public service. And we see that interdisciplinarity and that cross-sectoral base as absolutely fundamental to what we do and a real strength of RSE. And I think it very much plays to some of, Bridget, your opening comments around that importance of different forms of knowledge. So we bring together that academic understanding with that practitioner knowledge and expertise. And while RSE is Scotland's National Academy, we are not limited to Scotland. We have about 175 corresponding fellows who exist around the world, and we're part of a network of sister academies and work with them very closely on international research and collaboration. And I think if COVID has taught us anything, I think it's taught sorts of lots of things, but it has absolutely highlighted the importance of science and research, but also the importance and indeed necessity of global collaboration for public good. Again, I don't think I'll have any dissenting voices if I say that research and science is a continuing journey of development and discovery where the sharing of knowledge and of ideas is critical to scientific advances. But so much more so, I think, when that evidence and that knowledge is emerging, as we saw it was in COVID-19, and particularly in the early stages of the pandemic, when our knowledge was really quite limited and needed to develop very quickly. So the ability to be able to share knowledge, ideas, experiences, understandings across all sorts of boundaries was absolutely critical. But I think the important thing to say is that collaboration doesn't happen overnight. It comes back to some of James's point as well about connectivity. It's something you build up over time. And collaboration is both founded on and often a facilitator of the mobility of people and talent. And against that backdrop, RSE was delighted to offer earlier this year or to take part in the Saltire Awards programme, which was very much aimed at supporting connectivity and mobility and collaboration between Scotland and European partners in a post-Brexit landscape. So funded by the Scottish Government and delivered in partnership with the Scottish Funding Council, through the Saltire Research Awards, we've allocated £1.8 million of funding this year to 93 awardees and across 25 countries. And I think that's fantastic to have that level of collaboration through an awards programme that will not be just a one-off, but will be the basis of so much more collaboration on a continual and ongoing and growing basis. The awards have supported academics at different points in their careers, so from those starting off in their PhDs to those who are internationally renowned for their research. And I think importantly, and tying back to the interdisciplinarity point, these awards that were open to people from all backgrounds and disciplines. It wasn't limited to particular disciplines at all. And while we know that there's a challenge, obviously, that has been around travel, this was about the mobility of ideas as well as the mobility of people. So we've had some collaboration awards, which is, as the name suggests, support bilateral or multilateral projects between Scottish-based researchers and researchers in Europe. We've got early career fellowships, which provide PhD placements and early career placements for Scottish-based and European researchers in a research department of their choice, and that can be either in Scotland or in Europe. And we've got facilitation awards, which aim to fund bilateral and multilateral workshops and networks. And these are either aimed at supporting early stage development, so that those initiating conversations and discussions and collaboration, or actually networks which are actually more developed. And I think that's fundamental, particularly as we think about the next round of Horizon Europe funding as well. But of course, while global collaboration between researchers and universities is fundamental to advancing knowledge and the development of high quality research, it must go beyond that to ensure the practical application of knowledge and expertise. And James and Paul have spoken about the sort of the benefits of, James and Andreas have spoken about the business interaction. And there's quite a number of initiatives in Scotland that have been supporting university business collaboration. So we have Interface, which works with businesses of all sizes in all sectors to match some of Scotland's academic expertise and research facilities and functions across universities and colleges with businesses. And the Funding Council also support a number of innovation centres that aim to accelerate technological advances by forging new collaborations between businesses and researchers. And they cover everything from precision medicine to digital health to aquaculture to biotechnology. But very much at the heart that is about being a partnership between universities and the business community. And I think what we've seen is an increasingly broadening out of that collaboration. In particular, the triple helix model of innovation has been writ large in response to COVID, as we've seen academia, government and business come together, whether that's around vaccines or ventilators or face masks or therapeutics. That's a form of partnership that really was absolutely fundamental for us to be able to navigate away through the last couple of years. And I think that leads to some really important questions about how do we embed that as business as usual? How do we scale up those university, business and government collaborations? How can we ensure that there's the same collective effort that we saw in response to the acute crisis of COVID for some of the chronic challenges facing society, including climate change? And such collaboration, you know, is absolutely fundamental to addressing societal challenges and to pulling in resources from the private sector to support the funding of research as well. And certainly, as some of you will be aware, the UK government policy, which has a commitment to increasing the percentage of GDP spent on research, is very much underpinned by being able to draw in monies from the private sector. And not as an end in itself, but as a necessary underpinning to that research investment that enables those advancements in knowledge and their application for the benefit of society. Now, I was going to end there, but given Bridget mentioned policy, I'll say a little bit about that. And that comes from my experience of working in government for 16 years. And I've worked on all sides of the fence, as it were. I started as a researcher, and I actually started my career in academia. And then I worked in some sort of knowledge brokerage roles, and I worked as a policymaker. I moved to the dark side of policy, as the analysts used to say. But just a few reflections about the way we do evidence and advice. And this is quite simple, and I won't pretend it's anything more than that, but I think one of the things that sort of always struck me and sometimes continues to strike me is how easy it is to get some of the basics wrong. So one of the things is, as I said, about the importance of collaboration is about relationships, and it's no different in terms of building relationships between policy and academia. You need to build those relationships. A policymaker needs to be confident about where somebody is coming from and that they are the best route into evidence and not just one aspect of it. It's important that researchers understand the context in which they're providing advice and what policy needs to know, accepting that it doesn't always know what it needs to know, those sort of unknown unknowns, if you know what I mean. And the importance of communicating effectively. It's almost a too obvious thing to say, but I really just, the number of times that sort of, you know, you'd be landed when you're working in a policy role with these, you know, weighty tomes, which were no doubt fantastic and sort of in-depth research that, you know, is the bread and butter of academia. But as a policy person in a very busy environment, actually, that's not what you need. You need clear messages that synthesize, that give you a really easy account of the evidence. And then if you need to know more, then you can go for that further depth, but not providing it right at first. And then again, I guess what was really important was about integrated advice where possible, because as a policymaker, you don't want to just see one part of the picture. You don't want to just see one part of the jigsaw puzzle. You need it all together. So one of the areas I was working on was climate change, actually quite a long time in government. And at one point we had the sort of scientists at one hand were sort of providing advice on the impact of wind farms on the bird population. And then in a different part of the office, you had the economists sort of advising on the economic impacts. But if you're a minister or if you're in a policy role, you need all that evidence so you can take a holistic approach to decision making. And then managing that uncertainty. And that's really tricky. But again, we've seen it writ large in COVID. Often there'll be limits about how far the evidence can take us, and there'll be limits of our knowledge. But policymakers have a really difficult job and are often making very far-reaching decisions and will want to be confident in their choices. So being clear on what the evidence does say and what it doesn't say and any caveats is absolutely critical. And much of that is about getting the relationships and processes right. I also think though that there are some things that are critical in building confidence and supporting evidence-based policy. And one of the things again is being something that's been mentioned a number of times now, which is about recognising and valuing different forms of evidence and expertise. I've already mentioned the breadth of expertise that exists within RSE, combining academia and practitioner knowledge, but we've also been increasingly in our work thinking about, well, where does lived experience, where does expertise by experts by experience fit in? And we've just come to the end of a post-COVID futures commission that's been running for the last year and a half. And very much part of that process was trying to draw in those voices and that different form of understanding and experience and expertise to make sure that was part of the conversation and discussion. And you see that in government too. So for example, in Scottish government, where they've been developing a new welfare system, they've got a panel of experts or a panel of people with lived experience who are helping inform and design that policy. And that's critical because that will help how it lands on the ground and how successful it is. And I guess that's a wider point about collaboration. Academia, yes, business, yes, government, yes, but that all exists and sits within that societal context and making sure that the public are engaged in that debate. The public and we, all of us, are often at the sharp end of those decisions. We're often at the sharp end of technological developments, either for the good, but sometimes it might feel for some for the poorer. So actually, how do we make sure that the society are engaged in that? So I will end there, but I think I would just like to conclude by saying, you know, collaborative research is not a nice to have. It's absolutely not a nice to have. It's a necessity. It's a necessity of advancement, for advancement in our learning and our understanding, and it's fundamental to securing positive impacts for society. It supports new ideas. It supports new ways of looking at the world and new solutions to complex challenges and improving societal well-being. And I hope that the forum today and over its discussions tomorrow as well will help and support that coming together of disciplines, institutions, countries, reinforcing existing relationships and hopefully building a few new ones for the public and common good. Thank you, Bridget.
Thank you very much, Rebekah. an absolutely fantastic talk. And for me, what it kind of demonstrated is the importance of the institutional aspect of collaboration, knowledge development, and so on. So the RSA as an institution is both a voice and saying something about values, but also actually concrete enabling particular programs, you know, pushing forward certain agendas and how important that is. So I think we've had business, we've got academia, but we've also got the role of our institutions in actually shaping that. And I think that very strong, but the institutions also have a sense of creativity, of encouraging new ways, facilitating new ways of looking at collaboration, but then also putting programs in place that actually start to, in the social context, start to make those new innovations or new ways to engage, new kinds of collaboration to actually happen, whether that's with some of the funding in terms of early career researchers, but also citizens' panels and public engagement in agenda making, I think is really, really important. So I think that for me really came through very, very strongly. And the diversity and the richness of what you're doing at the RSA, I think, you know, again, inspirational and really important to have in this debate. Thank you very much. So Paul, hand over to you now. And I think in many ways, Paul, I think your focus on communities kind of rounds a lot of this up quite nicely. And then I think Stuart will give us a sense of how that's done in a particular place. So as always, the magic of just letting things happen, amazing things come out of it. So Paul, I'll hand over to you now.
Yeah, thank you very much, Bridget. So I'm very happy to have the chance here to present some of our current ideas in shaping the relationship to practice on multiple levels. So in my role as being responsible for cooperation with practice and entrepreneurship, it's my task to develop the strategy of our university and to push forward new formats, new projects, and finally also new communities for collaborating with practice. So just to make clear, our focus, for example, in the area of entrepreneurship is not just related to creating the next unicorn, but we have a special agenda dedicated to the topics of digital, social, sustainable, and also cultural entrepreneurship. So we really try to keep the whole range of all possible areas in that field. This also applies for cooperation with practice. So when we talk about cooperation with practice, we of course mean business, but we also develop our collaboration with schools, with museums, with cultural institutions, with NGOs, so with any actors of society who has a relation and interest in our research. So during the last month, we had the need to develop our strategy for cooperation with practice further and also to develop project proposals for advancing the collaboration with practice. And so I'd like to share my screen and providing you some insights. So my short talk is labeled from projects and formats to communities, and I will start with the project and also with some formats we recently started, and then finally conclude with our concept of communities, which we are currently developing and seeking to implement. So as mentioned, there's a need for addressing the current challenges like digitalization, for example, among others, in joint research projects. And so we started a project started in the end of 2019, but really it started in the beginning of 2020, so just around the pandemic. So we had the chance and also the need of moving this whole research project online. And so this is was quite challenging, as we have a lot of regional companies being involved. So when we talk here about digital entrepreneurship, it does not only focus on startup companies, but we also have a special look at, let's say, increasing the digital entrepreneurship skill set of incumbent companies. And we also look at what we call digital gazelles, so fast growing startups in the region with a focus on digital business models. So in this project, we work jointly. So this is what is always needed in this area if you want to fully address the challenges of digital transformation. So in this field, we have colleagues working together from three different disciplines over a period of 3 years. And we work jointly on topics, on problems, on issues with companies in the region. So according to the program we have, we seek to work jointly with about 20 SMEs in the region. So for this project is not only dedicated to support regional development and supporting companies and addressing their challenges, but also in setting up new formats. So as I'm coming from the information systems discipline, we have already for several years established methods related to action design research. So we create artifacts, methods embedded. So we work on the instance level, so to say, in the company, but also on an abstract level on which we seek to contribute to research. So our research here is really not just, you know, based on practical problems, but it's also based on the latest state of the art of knowledge from research. And we also seek to contribute while working on this practical cases and issues, seek to contribute to the ongoing research, but also publishing the results in top tier outlets. So besides that, we also started to launch some new formats, at least new for us. So we organized, for example, I will come back to this in a second, the first hackathon in Lüneburg. So this was after the federal government has launched a national hackathon dedicated to address societal challenges. Actually, planned and conducted and executed one locally, of course, again, completely digital. So this was a challenge, as normally these formats are based on a high degree of interaction between different people, different backgrounds. And so physical presence normally is really helpful. But anyway, we had to push this forward, and this was really a success. We brought more than 100 people together working on different topics, including, for example, the development of the inner city of Lüneburg and the city center. So developing new ideas on how it can actually be revitalized after the pandemic. So this is really, I think, a great success for Leuphana, but also for the companies involved. So it's really, I think highly of high relevance for the companies, but also addressing and related to current research issues. So, as I just said, besides running projects, which is of course something like, you know, the normal business in working with practice, and we have of course all different types of projects working with industries, we also seek to develop and improve our knowledge in having new formats. So I just mentioned this hackathon, so where people work jointly on social and economic issues in Lüneburg and the region. We also started it with our new podcast, but also we also created like a new method in another project called Sandbox Innovation, which is like design thinking approach, getting people, you know, involving people in design processes at the university, so we can build or we can provide a good space actually for people coming together from different backgrounds. So besides that, we also discuss the question of the locals, so to say, the question of where actually interaction with practice happens. And we currently see an increasing demand at our university for, let's say, new spaces, new types of rooms. And I guess many companies started to create digital labs or innovative spaces, co-working spaces, and so on. So we really seek to push forward our, let's say, setup at Leuphana in providing rooms which are necessary, new types of spaces which are necessary to bring together people from practice and universities. So this is actually the starting point for us to rethink, also to create maybe a new building in the next years, and to really open up besides, you know, the classic lecture hall and seminar rooms, to have some new types of experience in bringing people from practice and from university, including our students, of course, together in new formats. But we also increasingly think about what we call off-campus labs, so different places where we conduct research. So on the left side, you can see the TIP Innovation Park. That's a new commercial area which has been developed in Buchholz. And we just started now a project in which we explore the use of 5G technology with a local network spanning the whole area. So we can actually work jointly with companies, which are, you know, they are still creating the buildings at the site. So it's all in the planning and in the making. But this will be one of our off-campus labs to actually try out and work with 5G and companies in inter-organizational processes. So there will be robots driving around and drones. And so we have different types of technologies, but really to be used and tested at this place. We also engaged in several projects with the districts around us, in which we have people trying to experiment with new types of living, sustainable forms of living, and new social and organizational arrangements, and so on. So we have also some projects in this field where colleagues, especially from our School of Sustainability, work jointly with these actors at these sites together. So we actively think about actually, so there are of course many labs which we already use, people going out, but now it's our task actually to systematically map and also develop places in which we seek to collaborate with partners in our regional environment. So this imposes the challenge for us that we have now lots of design options when we think about creating collaborative settings. So we have lots of conferences established for certain topics running at our university. We have workshops, we have joint projects with students embedded into our curriculum. We have different means of funding. We have different modes of working, not just the classical, let's say, knowledge transfer, where knowledge from the university is being transferred to industry, but we seek to encourage open innovation. We seek to encourage multi-directional exchange, also fostering exchange between different actors from practice, right? So we are discussing, for example, to help the leaders of schools to exchange their ideas on how to become more innovative, to try out new formats at school, right? So we can actually be some kind of point where people meet, where people come together, where we exchange our ideas, present our ideas, but also where we can get lots of inspiration from practice. And finally, as I just said, we now have all this online hybrid virtual settings being available. And this offers also new potentials as we can extend our range. So we can address lots of people, many more people, right, compared to what we just had when we had meetings in presence, where we could attract maybe 50, 100 people. But now we can present also the results of our research to a broader audience. So this led us finally to think about what is actually the type of, is there some kind of overarching concept actually for developing cooperation with practice? And so during the last month, we developed with lots of discussions and also by now starting writing proposals on developing certain communities further. We thought that it is a good idea to go beyond projects with limited time of maybe 2 to 3 years running, and then the projects end, all people, you know, go into their own directions. And not just looking at formats, so we have of course some formats like conferences which run each year, but really looking on how we can systematically develop our communities, always based on our research areas. So that is always the essence for any type of collaboration, where we seek to get partners involved into these communities, which have really the interest of being part of this community for a longer time. So we call this self-sustaining. That means that all the actors involved have a shared interest in really pushing forward and running this community over a longer time. And it might also, of course, include some financial aspects. So if companies are involved, there might be some kind of contract related to this one to actually run the community. So, and finally, these communities should, have a place to be where they become visible. They can choose from all this diversity of formats, which we actually have, which I just presented. And they should all define and discuss actually which type of impact they want to make. And besides that, we see, of course, these communities as some type of generator of new ideas for joint projects for which then people, partners, actors in these communities might join for writing research proposals or transfer proposals or for going into direct exchange. So I think this, this is some kind of template that we seek to develop, which goes beyond the focal of single researchers. We always want to have multiple people being involved, multidisciplinary or transdisciplinary approaches, open innovation, and focusing on transformation, as this is the overarching, you know, topic we seek to address with our university. So communities contributing, understanding, being related to transformation of different areas of society. And so, we are now writing proposals actually for bringing this more, you know, to life actually, and developing some kind of initial cells that we have to the stage, while also learning on the abstract level of how this this type of community can be built and made sustainable. Great. So this was actually my contribution. I also saw lots of links to the previous speakers. And yes, we will come to this, I guess, in the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paul. Again, really insightful, sort of bringing things together. I think that really good thing that design sciences bring to us is bring it to practice. How might we actually do this and what are the practices of that? And I thought that was really, really interesting to pull that through. I really like the way you brought through the notion of open innovation and brought that into the discussion. I think that's really, really important. And I like the way you kind of almost the nuts and bolts, the on-campus labs, off-campus labs, the kind of more sort of community-driven approaches. But I think that notion of self-sustaining communities or learning communities, and I think there's something there, whether you're in business around energy or we're looking at things in terms of building communities around the COVID vaccine, but how we best implement and manage that at the community level. I think there's something really interesting there about how you develop self-sustaining communities in different places, and the learning that goes on there, because in a way actually then you're capturing intellectually but also tacitly what might or might not work. And of course then the issue is how can you share that tacit knowledge in a way, which is something I think that's always an issue. But I think that was really, really helpful. Now, unfortunately, Stuart Patrich can't be with us today. He's chief executive of the Glasgow Chamber of Commerce, but he sent me some notes, and in many ways he's contextualizing and really grounding many of the discussions we've had today. So he's going to talk about the role that the Glasgow business community believes that universities play in the economic development of cities. And he focuses very much on Glasgow itself. And as he says, I suspect you will not be surprised to find that the answer is that our universities are fundamentally important to Glasgow's prosperity, both now and into the future. And he draws on two main sources for that view. Number one is the research carried out by Glasgow City Council, Glasgow Chamber of Commerce and Glasgow Airport on the comparative economic performance of the city to help develop the business story. And that story kind of looks at how a city earns a living and why therefore a city is a good place to live and for businesses to invest. And the second source is the University of Glasgow, which only last month published an independent report by London Economics on the economic impact of the university. So I think here, what kind of Stuart's trying to sort of bring through are the different knowledge bases and how those come together in terms of a city, and the city is a made up of different institutions, different communities and so on and so forth, and how that comes together. So I'm not managing the video, so I think we'll probably move to the video.
Good afternoon, everyone, and may I apologize for being unable to join you today. Might I also convey the best wishes of Glasgow Chamber of Commerce to all involved in this important partnership, and especially to our friends from Niedersachsen. I've been asked to make a short contribution on the role that the Glasgow business community believes that our universities play in the economic development of our city. I suspect you will not be surprised to find that the answer is that our universities are fundamentally important to Glasgow's prosperity, both now and into the future. I can draw on two main sources for that view. Number one is the research carried out by Glasgow City Council, Glasgow Chamber of Commerce and Glasgow Airport on the comparative economic performance of the city to help us develop our city's business story. That story or narrative helps us explain how our city earns a living and why, therefore, the city is a good place in which businesses should invest. The second source is from the University of Glasgow itself, which only last month published an excellent independent report by London Economics on the economic impact of the university. The city's business narrative has been developed based on an independent assessment of over 450 indices comparing cities all around the world since 2012. Glasgow is Scotland's largest city and its commercial and creative capital, and with a regional population of just under 2 million, is by size alone a top 30 European city. The evidence showed, however, that the awareness of Glasgow as a business city was lower than the average, and the business narrative is designed to help overcome that challenge. I suspect that holding the United Nations Climate Conference COP26 over the past 2 weeks will have helped us increase awareness in the short term. Having an agreement with the city's name attached, the Glasgow Climate Pact, will help us maintain the city's profile in the months and years ahead. Our task is to turn that awareness into positive economic development decisions, and the business narrative is one tool to help us achieve that. Embedded in the city's business narrative are four messages that depend on the work of our universities. First, our skills and talent base is strong and increasing. By European standards, a very high share of our workforce has at least degree level qualifications. We sit in the top 15% of regions in Europe on that measure. Glasgow has the second largest student population in the UK at over 185,000, and with strong pipelines of talent in core disciplines such as finance, engineering, and life sciences. That would not be possible without our universities, and skills remains the primary reason why major corporates invest in our city. Second, our city is refreshing its capacity for innovation and creativity. The contribution universities make to commercial research and development is essential. Sectors like precision medicine and health technologies, photonics and quantum engineering, fintech, and space communications and satellite technology are all based on work done in our universities. The development of innovation districts as platforms for converting academic research into commercial application will be at the heart of the city's innovation strategy, and those districts are led by our universities. The London Economics report puts numbers on that for the University of Glasgow. Out of the university's total annual economic impact of £4.4 billion, the university's research work accounts for £1.8 billion, fully 40% of the total. Third, our educational institutions are high in the world standings, and that alone helps project the city's capabilities. Glasgow is the only city in the UK outside of London to have two universities in the UK's top 40. And of course, Glasgow University itself is the Times Higher Education University of the Year, is ranked 73rd in the world in the QS World University Rankings, and is investing £1 billion in improvements to its campus. These facts alone help Glasgow tell its business story. Finally, the city has a good fit with the lifestyle preferences of the new generations. Glasgow has been rated as the best European city for new graduates based on cost of living, satisfaction with culture and leisure facilities, and economic growth. The universities are the largest landing platform for attracting that fresh talent to the city, and they help create a virtuous circle of improvement. Glasgow University's success in growing its overseas student population to just under 10,000 is bringing diversity to our city. The number of Asian business starts in the university's surrounding neighborhood being just one example. That diversity in turn increases Glasgow's attractiveness. So our universities provide our city with a talent pipeline, the research capability from which we can grow the next wave of new industries, project Glasgow's image around the world through their own excellence, and help create the fresh diversity of lifestyles that any city needs to attract new talent. How can anyone doubt the importance of our universities to the future prosperity of our city? Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Stuart, even though that was you're not here. I think that was a lovely way to kind of pull it together. And I think very much to the point, I think, evidence-based and to the point with it, with an interpretation and narrative to go with it. And I think, again, I mean, I can't talk for Glasgow, but as for Glasgow University, but I think the role of universities as a civic institution is quite well rehearsed in the UK. But I think here the diversity of the impact of universities in terms of, you know, the talent pipeline, skills, as well as startups, are quite specific aspects of that. But I think the wider impact of the culture and in sort of bringing new generations to particular places and keeping that diversity, that creativity going, that's sort of in the ether almost, is in itself an attractor. It's something that's hard to quantify, but I think it's something that facilitates a kind of imagination, a kind of imagination where we can ask different questions, an imagination of where things might be possible, an imagination to ask what if. And I think here, rich, diverse community life is really, really important. So I think that notion of what we can quantify is really helpful. But I also think those other things that we can't quite quantify and are harder to grasp are also important. Rather like our energy production, our cultural environment, our cultural energy, our imagination is crucially important. I feel a bit like a politician now at the COP, but kind of saying without that imagination, you know, how do we find a way forward? So I think there's again, a little bit of a return to away from metrics and stats, which are very important, which have been embedded in our educational system from young people for how we sort of educate our young people, is also still having space for the arts, for entertainment, for drama, for those kinds of expressions and cultural spaces for people to try things out. And Paul, certainly in terms of design and innovation, we know that creativity is really, really important. So I think that's really helpful. Okay, so many, many thanks. I've really enjoyed the talks. I don't know if any of you, we've got some questions coming in, but whether any of you would like just to say a word before we move to questions, or something that came up for you during the actual panel that you felt was interesting or important.
There are a few thoughts on connectivity, listening in particular to Paul, which might be helpful. First, if I run a business, which I do, if I invest into business, there is an abundance of projects which are usually proposed. And basically, there are 10 on the table, and the most important thing is to take the decision which aid to kill. So the issue of focus is clear, absolutely specific, clear to important for success. And if I translate that, what does that mean for connectivity is, as I said before, issues, problems are very specific. And the community I want to join, or I need to join, if I don't want to spend my time with noise, needs to be relevant to what's really important to me. And I will probably have different level of communities I want to be part of. One of is probably a high level network of decision makers where I connect with people around that issues who are relevant in decision making on the political side, relevant on the academic side, relevant in other industries as well, even competitors. And there is probably a specific level of factual technical issues, gaining more insight around the themes where I want to build connectivities. And I would expect both of those communities not to be rooted at one local area, let's say Glasgow or Lüneburg, but I would expect the community or I want to join around that specific issue which I may have to build to be spread out, maybe even globally. And I just wanted to add that perspective, because I think that's very important if one wants to encourage community building, sustainable community building in academic centers. If you do end up with 5-6 significant communities, expect them to be playing, to have very different people connecting to them, very different rules, agendas, how they are managed, being very specific as well, and they may change the world.
Thank you very much, Andreas. I don't know if anybody will respond to that. We've got one question from James. James McCallum, do you want to?
Bridget, just picking up on the point that Andreas makes there around focusing on the opportunity, and indeed picking up on Paul's words around entrepreneurship. Being entrepreneurial is around identifying opportunities and running with those opportunities, sometimes well ahead of the pack, and or indeed even a recognition that there is indeed an opportunity. And much of what I'm sure we will talk about in the panel is we're living in a time where there are enormous opportunities, and I'd love to talk to that a little bit more. But I did want to just focus in on a word which you use, which all too often you don't hear business people talking about, and that is the word of creativity. I think you raised it there, and Rebekah touched on it, and it is incredibly important to recognize the importance of creativity, because particularly in the space of entrepreneurship, because the vast majority of successful entrepreneurs, successful business leaders, are also very successful storytellers. If you're going to build connectivity and you're going to take people with you on a journey, particularly around new ideas in business, you need to be able to tell the story, and you need to be to win converts sometimes or supporters. And the way to do that is around embracing creativity. So I often I think that is not seen as a key talent of business leaders, and it's a real miss when people don't see that as essentially important. So I wanted to applaud you for putting that sixth C in the room.
And I think Stuart gave us that lovely story of the way they built the story of Glasgow as well, in a very concrete way. So that's a nice way of linking that in. All right, Paul, do you want to, and then I'll open it up to the floor.
Yeah, thanks. So directly to this point. So first of all, we really seek to embed these types of teaching also in our curricula. So we have actually, I'm running a digital innovation lab, how it's called, completely multidisciplinary, with students from all different areas trying to understand digital technologies and creating solutions based on that, you know, so running through a design thinking process, trying this out. But this is a new type of learning, which we don't normally find in our curricula. There are other types of creativity, of course, expected and fostered in different types of, you know, engineering fields or so, but this is definitely something I guess all students can profit from, and it's really necessary, not only for entrepreneurship, but also, or at least if you call it, you know, some kind of intrapreneurship. If you are in an incumbent organization and try to change things, you need to come up with new ideas. So I guess this is also something we need to address as universities. So I wanted to just briefly address Andreas' point related to local versus global. So I guess the community building we are currently looking at is first of all our regional responsibility as a university in our area, as we are the only university in this field. And so there are many partners in practice, including schools, including also companies for manufacturing production. So they actually expect from us to some kind of facilitate knowledge exchange in this area. And so far we have some kind of, you know, small starting points for this, but we really want to first systematically develop this in our region. And this also means in the region of Hamburg, because we see ourselves as part of the overall metropolitan area of Hamburg. So, but this leaves or brings me actually to a second point, and this is, let's say, the global of change, exchange of communities. And I guess this quite well fits here into this exchange. So it's actually the next step in our strategy after we have successfully managed to implement these local and regional exchange communities to more look at the development at global communities. And I guess this works completely different in many ways. Maybe we can learn from our regional communities, but I guess this is could be a very interesting starting point for further discussions on the relationship between Scotland and Lower Saxony, to think about how we can actually establish such communities in areas in which our universities have expertise in research and in which there's a joint interest also of partners, regional partners, museum schools, I don't know, or businesses from production, manufacturing, to exchange, to take part. For example, we will start a community now related to sustainable production. I guess there will be a high interest in any area in Europe today in joining such communities. So extending our concept actually to the European level or to an international level is on our agenda, but not yet the next point to be realized. So would like to discuss this issue further also with all people who are interested in thinking communities, setting up communities globally. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. And Rebecca's talk and the work of the RSE there in terms of the global as well as the Scottish, I think is quite a useful model to pick up on that. Is everybody happy for me now too? I've got three questions lined up. Well, I've got more. I've got four questions, and one from our great Bridget Fowler, which is great. So first one from James Conroy at University of Glasgow. And his question is, how do we match the drivers and incentives for those driving business surpluses, including those who write the algorithms, with those who focus on the ethical, public-facing, PR, greening claims and responsibilities of business that are often, as there is often quite a significant gap? Did everybody get that? So I don't know whether, James, you want to have a go at that first, or who might want to?
Yeah, I'll definitely have a go at that. And I saw it and read it in the Q&A room, and no surprise, great question from James. I think the middle sentence there seemed to infer how do we deal with the issue of what I would refer to as greenwashing. I'm not sure that that's the point which James is actually making, but I'll touch on that just for a second. You know, clearly, if you like, there is a formal policy dimension to this in how we actually address people who are if you like the polluters of the world in the world, and ultimately we may see that being dealt with blunt instruments like carbon tax, for instance. However, those are blunt instruments. You know, clearly we have not made enough progress to this point by hoping that people will do the right thing, particularly in the business sector, because there hasn't necessarily been the compulsion. But I think the point which I was alluding to earlier on is ironically, in the course of the last 5 years, we have seen the financial sector take a lead on this. And I was actually talking about this with a banking colleague actually yesterday morning, and I was actually asking him for his perspective on why do you think the financial industry has gone out ahead of business, even gone out ahead of the politicians in this particular space? And his view was very much that the finance sector is trying to get a grounding on how it deals with a world where we have got so used in a pre-inflationary environment to 0% interest levels, which means it's very difficult for banks to make money. And the sector that they are looking to be transformational is the environmental sector and businesses associated with that. Now, I take encouragement from that because what they've actually driven into the space there is that they're beginning to say that we will, through data, decide who are the good companies who we will lend money to at lower interest rates, and who are the bad companies who will either attract higher interest rates or will not have access to liquidity of capital at all. Now, in business, that is the most acute point at which it gets the attention of CEOs and CFOs. If you cannot access capital to either grow your business or acquire other businesses, it is the most fundamental breakdown between your growth aspirations and what you're actually doing. So I think this connectivity to a financial instrument will bring about the change that you're seeking, James. That would be my answer to that.
Thanks, James. Andreas, do you want to?
Slightly different notch. If you look at the evolution over the last 20 years, obviously many industries, including the energy industry, haven't changed fast enough into the right direction, although everybody was aware about the signs was clear 25, 30 years ago. So if I look now at the relationship between Volkswagen and Tesla, just to pick out a concrete example, the huge financial disadvantage of Volkswagen on the bottom line financially is the cost of emission trading certificates, because they have to pay expensive money because they are on the wrong side of the industry, while Tesla is actually selling those certificates. They are gaining money on that. And if I'm informed correctly, getting that right has double the impact than succeeding in the marketplace for the CEO of Volkswagen. So therefore, I think setting the right political frame, not intervention, but the right rules of the game to set the right financial incentives for commercial actors, I think, even if they are blunt, it's highly important. Direct intervention, I don't think that the political level does have the knowledge to find the right solutions on the specific level that needs to be sorted out by academia, by the involved parties on the local level, who are usually business. That's where the innovation takes place, and the insight and the creativity to find the good solutions.
Thanks, Andreas. Paul and Rebecca, anything to add? No? Right, no, I think James, a really incisive and I think important question that I think will be on the agenda for quite some time as we try to work towards some kind of solution for that. The next question is from Sonia Frankie Arnold from Glasgow. And I think, you know, she points out scientific work is by its very nature collaborative and international. And she welcomes the added opportunities via the Scotland Niedersachsen partnership. But what she's posing is, I imagine that this will be more difficult for entrepreneurship and industrial components where IP is hard enough in one country. Any thoughts? So this is about IP in collaboration and partnerships, I think, not just in countries, but across different countries. So I don't know who would like to pick up on that question or have any thoughts in response to Sonia's question. Paul.
Yeah, thank you for raising this point. I just want to point out that I think we see that, especially in the area, let's say, of social and sustainable innovation and activities, there's a high interest of all actors involved in sharing knowledge instead of keeping it or restrictedly keeping it on their own to make profits out of it, but actually they seek to spread their ideas, to work in open innovation setup, and to involve anyone who is interested in that field. So I'm currently supporting an initiative in Hamburg, working at developing a digital innovation for payment to homeless neighbors, as they call it. So some kind of digital innovation project. And they are actually keen of sharing their ideas globally with anyone. So I see really a huge potential in, let's say, new forms of organizing and new forms of business, which are grounded on building successful business models, but not that much based on protected IP. So I guess this is really an opportunity for many areas. Of course, not for all areas of business, but I see that this is really something that allows us to collaborate in globally, at least in those areas, quite intensively without raising any IP issues.
Anybody else from the panel wishing to add anything to Paul's?
Yeah, if I may, you know, it's an issue which crops up regularly, and I think I've always taken the approach that says, you know, focus on the actual opportunity itself first, identify the opportunity and get after it. Trying to lock down intellectual property rights right at the very beginning of a project, in my experience, has always stifled creativity. It's always stifled the freedom of thought and the ability to go after what the success looks like. I mean, I've enjoyed collaborating with academia over the building of four companies. And when we've ultimately successfully built a business around that, there has always been value attributed to all of the parties. And I think that point came through in terms of the conversation or the representation of the other speakers, where, you know, it's important to work hard to identify what success means to each of the individual parties. But once you've understood what success is, just get after it. I've always believed that the IP issue sorts itself out down the line, and don't put it at the front end. You know, address it once you've actually got something to really worry about.
Thanks, James. Rebekah or Andreas, any thoughts? No.
No, I just would like to underline the notion which James just had. Trust the process. Don't put all the what could happen up at the beginning. If you do have a good teaming in place, focus, go for it, and sort it out when it's on the table.
Thank you, Andreas. So I think if we go to the next question from Christopher Kleinberg, his question is, should universities make particular efforts to set up partnerships with companies, for example, SMEs and communities they would otherwise not reach in order to be inclusive and diverse, or rather focus on existing contacts and achieve significant results with highly significant results with a rather elite group from. So I think the question is, do you go for diversity, broadness, something that's probably universities wouldn't ordinarily reach out to, or do you actually focus on existing contracts where there's probably more confidence that you might achieve significant results? And of course, I think this is really interesting because this goes to the point of some of the kind of Rebekah's coming in, some of the points there in terms of, you know, where does that innovation come from? What creativity, for whom, by whom? So I'll hand over to Rebekah, I think, to pick that up.
Thanks so much, Bridget. And I think some of this maybe connects with the next question as well from Bridget around the marketization of universities. I mean, I think the first thing I'd say is, I don't think it should ever be done as a tick box. I'm not implying that was what the question said, but it's not an end in itself, engaging with SMEs and local communities. It's or even just to be diverse and things. It's actually thinking quite critically about what are we engaging for, to what end, what are we trying to achieve, and what are we trying to achieve for those communities as well, and those SMEs, because it's their time that's going into this as well as the university's time. I mean, there's been increasing conversations across the UK, slightly a less extent in Scotland, or certainly the terminology is maybe slightly different, around civic universities and what is actually the role of a university. And I think universities have both a challenge and an opportunity in terms of the different spatial scales at which they operate. They're local, they're regional, they're national, they're international. And that can be quite complex when you've got limited resources, thinking about what you offer in each of those spaces and those priorities. And you know, we know there's a lot of pressure on academics to do lots of different things. So there is a question about prioritising within that and thinking about what the incentive structures support or don't support. But having said that, I think there's it's tried to not position this as an either or, that either you engage at a local level, you engage with SMEs and communities and seek to be diverse and inclusive and the creativity and ideas that come from that, or you operate as a sort of an international superstar university. And I think you find, you know, Glasgow University does this, I think, actually really pretty well. It is both local and global. So I think it's balancing some of that. So it's not easy, but I think there's ways of not making it an either or. But I think it comes back to the fact that the university is thinking about what are they for and who are they trying to be for and what are they trying to achieve. And I think one of the things about universities is, and one of the great strengths of them is their heterogeneity. They're not all the same, and nor should they all try and be the same. And we should see that as a strength, that some may very much be focused on their local and maybe more regional communities, and others may be much more focused on the sort of international stage. There's not a right or wrong, and we actually need universities that do all of those things.
Thanks, Rebekah. Paul.
Yes, I guess this really touches an important issue. So being responsible for actually managing, the large proposals that we're currently writing and, approaching organizations in our region, we see that, of course, we have a strong network to certain actors in our region, with whom we have long relationships over years, and it's easy to call them, and we know there's, a basis of trust, so they will agree in supporting our proposals after brief discussions and presentations. But of course, it's also our interest to reach out, and I guess I'd like to come back to the role of the Chambers of Commerce, actually. So we regularly take part in opportunities to present our research and activities to a broader audience of companies in our region, to really also address those who might have not thought that much about artificial intelligence or sustainable production, but who may find the first contact to these topics with such a talk by one of our colleagues. And when I look to the project I just presented, those are at least those companies which have realized that they have a challenge of in the field of digitalization, right? So this is why they agreed actually in working with us. So there's definitely a high number of companies in the region which have not yet realized how big the challenge might be for them due to platform-based businesses or other challenges occurring. So I guess, yes, this is really an important challenge. So we try to leverage actually all types of actors who work as, who can multiply our voice. And just one final comment, maybe. Of course, it's also a way to go for universities to explicitly hire people and to set up professorships whose duty is to, for example, work together with social institutions in the area or to foster sustainable entrepreneurship and really address a broad audience of organizations in the field. So I guess that is also part of, the strategy, or could be part of the strategy, to set up professorships or institutes which are dedicated to reach a broader audience and not just those who are always involved in the projects of universities for lots of years. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody at James? Anybody want?
Yeah. Look, I mean, I think the two sides of Bridget and Christoph's questions are really interesting. I will declare. My position on this in as much as that I think the universities in any particular country have a strong level of responsibility to understand, if you like, the economic landscape in which they actually operate. But having said that, and I'll come back to that in a second, I think Bridget's point is that they also need to maintain an independence from that in order to demonstrate thought leadership. And I suspect we could probably spend all evening discussing the two sides of this particular coin going forward. The one thing I will say, which around concern about sticking, if you like, all the time to the large companies that you've been operating with, is today we live in a real danger that we surround ourselves with the people who reflect our views on things, and we live in various versions of echo chambers in terms of the way we read newspapers, the way we receive media, and perhaps even the way we receive sponsorship in the context of this particular question. And I think that's very dangerous. It's very dangerous to stay with the people who like the arguments that you put forward and support your research because they like the arguments that you put forward. It becomes self-fulfilling and self-defeating in itself. But I do think, again, coming back to the point which Rebekah made in her talk, you know, when you have organisations like the Scottish Chamber of Commerce or like Scottish Enterprise, and I'm talking from a Scottish perspective, but I'm sure exactly the same it exists with our colleagues in Germany. And there is a focus in those organisations into key thematic areas which can make a material difference for the country in which you actually live. Then the universities have an important role to play in supplying into that, both supplying intellectually and supplying resource into that. We cannot, as countries across Europe, be all things to all people. We have to understand where we can differentiate ourselves and have a distinct advantage. And hopefully we'll get that right. Stuart touched on some of the key thematic areas which are important to Glasgow, and they reflect, not surprisingly, the economic strategy of Scottish Enterprise in that particular space. I'd have been deeply concerned if they were the opposite. But the reality is the universities should be playing into that. So for me, whilst I take Bridget's point, it is incredibly important to maintain that individual identity off to the side to be able to challenge accepted wisdoms. It is also important to diversify and broaden the bandwidth of who you're listening to and who you're talking to when you're looking across collaboration between universities, the politicians and business.
Thanks, James. Andreas, anything I think you want to add, or you're fine? Okay. I think before I go on to Bridget's question, I think very much, you know, the answer's coming back there very much around still that notion of having to develop critical capacity. I think universities there about being critical in relation to some of these things. So I think and an engagement and an ability to debate, I think is kind of really important. And practical, you know, practical issue is that when we look at Dame Wendy Hall, I mean, Dame Wendy is trying to get recruitment of diversity within the workplace for AI, because she can see from her perspective that unless you have that diversity, you're going to increase the bias rather than decrease the bias to something that might become very infrastructural to how we live. So I think there's something there about we might have thematics, we've certainly got intellectual support, so I'm being playing devil advocate here a bit, James, and we've got resources. But I think that notion of critical skills and to be able to bring something that we haven't seen into the agenda at the right time is crucially important. And of course, then we have to think about wider issues around social values and so on and so forth. And here the role of universities are important. But I think that critical engagement and knowing how to debate are again skills that sometimes get overlooked. Mm-hmm. And I think that diversity question is even more important now as we go into that fourth industrial revolution, whether, you know, it's highly debated, but nonetheless, the platform economy, AI and so on, is increasingly structuring our connectivity and can affect the characteristics and the openness of our societies to innovate for social justice, but also for the way which we want to come together as a community that's vibrant, forward-looking and inclusive. So I think that those are really important questions. So now to Bridget Fowler's thought and also questions. So Bridget says, I'm anxious about the increasing marketisation of universities themselves in the UK and to a lesser extent the US, which I think is increasingly detrimental to the wider purposes of universities as well as to creative collaborations. I mean by this, for example, the increasingly bimodal allocation of resources, such as the casualisation and precarisation of teaching to undergraduates, along with the very high pay of superstar profs, in brackets, and vice principals and principals. And two, the Matthew effect, those who shall be given in terms of competitive allocation of research funds following the very bureaucratized research assessment exercise. I'd like to know whether the panel has any views about this. So open to thoughts on that. And I think a really interesting question, because it's what is the role of universities, but that where does creativity come from? You know, what enables it? And, you know, that voice, you know, if we think about the climate debate and the environment, those voices very early on that weren't heard, you know, there's something quite interesting around that. So any questions or any thoughts?
Well, I think much of that was addressed in the conversation that we just had a second ago. And ultimately, the word here probably is balance, isn't it? I mean, you know, where is the balance in all of this? I think it is fundamental that universities, as sources of research and the development of knowledge, have to have a voice, especially when that voice is contradictory to the status quo. I think that's an extraordinarily important part of our universities. Against that, there is a commercial reality that universities are increasingly businesses in and of themselves. They are increasingly not supported by government funding that might help to maintain that independence of perspective. And I think finding the way by which those businesses, the universities being those businesses, can, if you like, maintain that balance will become increasingly challenged, especially if it's underpinned by the same financial sponsorship from corporate environments, which is what I touched on a second ago. So I don't have an answer there for Bridget's question, other than to say that I think it's an incredibly important area for every university board to try to be getting right. Clearly there are others on the panel probably much more acutely able to answer this than me as a corporate business person.
They want to hang on to it. We've got another couple of questions, and I'm told we've got 10 minutes, but I think it is also then raises questions about leadership. I think Rebekah there about leadership in terms of universities, within the universities, and that notion of we don't know where the next idea is going to come from. You know, the history of in sort of invention and innovation shows often it's somewhere we don't expect to see it. So I think not only in terms of personal fulfillment of people working within the universities, I think that space to try things out is something that we need to protect, both for innovation but also for our knowledge base going forward. All right, David Patterson from St Andrews asks, do universities recognise work with industry properly, e.g. in the promotion criteria? I guess, Paul, it's probably your space and probably my space more to answer that. Have you got any ideas?
Yeah, so I think it depends. So actually, we can see that industry work has been recognized in engineering, for example, at least in Germany universities to a high degree. So it's there's even a way to replace actually a habilitation, which is normally required for a full professorship, with industry experience. So this is really some kind of something that's formalized in the process. In other areas, I guess we don't see it that much, but we have at least a discussion at our university to find out how, if we say we want to be a transformational university, that we want to have impact, how that actually influences our promotion criteria, right? So how we actually look at people applying to the positions that we offer. So that is really something where we at least started to discuss about looking beyond publications. I guess that's the key point, and maybe also looking beyond third-party funds which you attracted. So really to see how you can look at impact that people might have had, and so that personally, so I've been working as a consultant for 10 years, so you might have seen this on my slides again, and this was Andreas' comment, so I guess that's really, so I always crossed borders. I've been working, I had started two companies when I was 18 and 20, besides studying, I worked besides doing my PhD, so I was always crossing lines, and I guess for academia, this is very helpful to at least, now I'm thinking of the faculty as some kind of portfolio. So you need some people which are really focusing on basic research, and you know, they might be far away actually from practice. But I guess you also need people who are really capable in speaking different languages, in bridging all those challenges which Andreas addressed in his talk, right? So, and I guess for that it's really helpful. So I think it's not, should not be maybe a criterion for all jobs, for all positions, but there is the need actually for some people who have the dedication in shaping the fields of industry practice relationship. And for them, I think it is quite valuable if they have experience from practice.
Thanks, Rebecca.
Yeah, because I think this connects with Bridget's question as well about what's valued and what's rewarded and the incentive structures obviously that exist within universities. And again, they'll differ in different places, and not just in terms of promotion criteria, but also in terms of funding, in terms of the availability of sabbaticals, for example, and time for people to go and do different things. And I guess that does connect to the research assessment exercise. And I think the in the UK, the bringing in of the impact agenda has, you know, resulted in a level of shift in terms of some of that work being recognised. But I still think that both industry and policy are probably seen in some areas as a bit of mix of the sort of slightly poor relations. But just one thing, just building on the last point, as well as I guess what I'd like to see is much more porosity between sectors as well. So you're not just in academia or in industry that actually, or in government, that there's much a much greater flow in and out of the different sectors, rather than seeing that it's you're this or you're that, because I think that would strengthen collaboration and would help get a better understanding of what the different experiences bring to the table. And hopefully then they will get better reflected in incentive structures.
I think that's really interesting, very, very useful. I think it is disciplinary based as well. I think different disciplines have to have different understandings of that. And I think also we need to remember that not everybody is the same in working in a university. Like any organisation, you'll have people who have got particular strengths and particular interests. And I think sort of understanding, you know, some people extremely scholarly and don't want to collaborate, other people are much more collaborative and work. And I think it's finding spaces and pathways for those different routes through, given that our knowledge, you know, there's all that work done years ago by the folks at SPRU, Science Policy Research Unit, down at Sussex, about modes of knowledge production. And if we are in the mode two, we're probably in mode three, four, five, and six now since that was written. But that notion of, you know, how we produce knowledge just changed historically. But that doesn't mean to say that we throw out the traditional academics. We've probably got new forms of academics. Just as we've got planes, we still have canals and so on and so forth. So there's probably different purposes. But I guess then that's an internal question for university leadership in terms of promotion. So James, a point from James Conroy, which is not so much a question, but an endorsement of James's comments about echo chambers, most especially concerned with respect policymakers, but also in the challenges for university and business. So I think this is probably, I don't know if James wants to kind of expand on that a little bit. But I think what we have been talking about is that maybe we need to, we're engaging with knowledge in different ways, and different stakeholders will intersect with that knowledge or see knowledge in a different way and work with knowledge as something that is useful. I mean, if we think of data as something that is, you know, expresses something, that measures something in a way, we can think of information as coming from data, as informing us. But what's that transition to knowledge? How do we turn information? How do we turn data into information and information into knowledge? And again, I think that's where collaboration and partnerships, but how we do that and what that knowledge means. And I think also the justice and social fairness of that knowledge and where that comes through is particularly important. I think that's what James meant. Don't know if he's there to say any more. But any thoughts on James's endorsement, I think, before we close? I think we're about to finish.
If I just may, rounding out in a couple of points and trying to summarise on that, and nice to get an endorsement from James, I'll take that for sure. But if I pick up on Rebekah's point around the porosity of thought leadership, the one thing I would say is, in my own experience here, particularly where you have contrarian views, and great developments often come from contrarian view, is it doesn't happen simply by an absorption. You have to put the different views into the room. You have to get people collaborating around the table. If you simply wait for it to happen, it either won't happen or it will take too long. And in much of the issues that we've actually been talking about today, we do not have time. Time is the one dimension today that we didn't talk an awful lot about, particularly with regards to the environment. We don't have a lot of time. And I would just close out on something that Andreas actually said, which I'd love to take up with you on, Andreas, because I have very, very strong views on the fact that whether or not we actually knew the situation we'd find ourselves in today, 25 years ago, when we were actually embracing the sort of like the energy impact on the environment. At the very least, I'm sure we would all accept that it was an inconvenient truth both then and perhaps even still now. But we've got to address that inconvenient truth. We are all implicated in it now. We all have a different part and a different capability to bring to that solution. But the only way we will do that quickly and effectively is if we all get round the table. And if that is not an endorsement for collaboration, I don't know what is.
Thank you very much, James. And I don't think there's anything to add to that, really. We've run slightly over and I don't think I need to summarise, but I will say many, many thanks to all our speakers. And I think especially for the thoughtful interjections and points raised and how they bounced off each other. And again, it's that notion of knowing how to debate, knowing how to bring things to the table is certainly a skill set we haven't talked about. Time, I think, is interesting. But I think that's probably for another time and another, excuse the pun, and another conversation. But I think let's keep the conversations going. And Judith, I'll hand over to you now. But many, many thanks to our speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for a very brilliant panel discussion. And I would hope that we can take up the topic of time then maybe at the next joint forum next year in person. Which would be wonderful. And I hope everyone enjoyed the discussion. And now we will have a short coffee break so everybody can relax a bit before we continue with the last point of our program for today, which is an informative session on funding and support opportunities for Lower Saxony and Scottish projects. I will see everyone back at 4 o'clock Scottish time and 5 o'clock German time. And thank you very much to our panelists and our brilliant moderator, Bridget.